NBA basketball is a game of training and dedication. Large men strain towards great goals. Pleasure and pain intermingle, and the quest for the NBA title is fueled by pride and passion. This was a season of newfound success and technical knockouts, fancy fantasy, and hard reality. Runaway victories and dramatic confrontations, close calls, and long shots. But mostly in 1983-84, the NBA raised its game a notch. New stars began to shine, and the level of play rose. The game, already exciting, grew fierce. Stars used a lifetime of skills to score, while newcomers seemed to have a life of their own. There were classic matchups and new combinations, slick slants and sweet stuff. NBA basketball, pride, and passion. One man with every reason to be proud was Kareem Abdul-Jabbar. In 1984, Kareem was approaching Wilt Chamberlain's all-time scoring record. On April 5th, the moment arrived.
Three backs here. Hook shot. It's up. Hook shot.
With his trademark, the skyhook, Abdul-Jabbar set a new standard that may never be broken. The next night, the Forum crowd and Wilt himself paid tribute to the greatest scorer in NBA history.
Kareem is a very talented individual, and he has proved that he's durable. And that may be the key word to it. He's played a lot of years with two or three guys hanging on him, and he's done a tremendous job.
He's the man. You know, he accomplished everything. And I'm just happy that I'll be able to tell my kids one day, hey, I was on the team with the legend.
Finally, I want to thank all of you people who came out here tonight for caring and showing your support. It's wonderful to be able to share this moment with so many wonderful people. Thank you very much.
When Kareem retires, he will join a select group of basketball legends. This winter in Denver, Red Auerbach was chosen, victory, cigar and all, to coach the East squad at the NBA's inaugural old-timers game. Coaching the West, Alex Hannum had his own words of wisdom. And the sellout crowd was ready for the golden age of hoop. The game itself promised to be part nostalgia, part ego. Johnny Red Kerr in the pivot looked slick, if not sleek. And Coach Hannum called his number again. But Tommy Heinsohn wasn't going to let him pull that stuff. In fact, Heinsohn tried to pull some stuff of his own. It was not out of character, And his old teammate, Casey Jones, wasn't a bit surprised. But after a few chuckles, the old fire took over. Pride and ability shone through, and the exhibition became a real game. Havlicek, hustling as he'd done 10 years before, dove and drove and made up for lost time. Hondo looked like he'd never left, and Red Auerbach no doubt wished he hadn't. The Hawks swooped to the hole, and the greats raised their game. Oscar got all net. Rick Barry challenged underneath, but the great Nate Thurman shut him down, swatting the ball away and leaving Barry deflated as well. But some moves are eternal. The Pearl unearthed one of his treasures. Pro ball has progressed, and each classic old-timer's move can be found in almost any game today. The West beat the East 65-63. For these all-time greats, if the body won't last forever, the camaraderie will.
Your mind is telling you to do things, but your legs just won't do them. So it is slow motion at times, but your mind is still working quickly.
The events were flying by. On one power-packed NBA weekend, Denver played host to the old-timers game, the NBA All-Star game, and the rousing return of the slam dunk contest. Julius Erving, the reigning king of the jams, had to defend his crown against a new generation of Skywalkers. The winner and new slam dunk champion, Larry Nance.
Billions of people in the world who play basketball. And this game signifies that you're one of the top 24 in the world.
Crowds gathered to see basketball's best shine brightly at Denver's McNichols Arena for the 1984 NBA All-Star Game. The league's leading lights were there, plus a fresh lineup of first-time All-Stars, including Jeff Rulin, Kevin McHale, Mark Aguirre of the Dallas Mavericks, Utah's Ricky Green, and Ralph Sampson. Also making his All-Star debut was coach Frank Layden, a real showman.
I hope in some way I'm helping that way. I think fans come to be entertained, and I hope I add to the entertainment.
Julius Erving started off in high gear. The Doctor hit 10 of his game-high 34 points in the first quarter, but the West ran off to a 17-point lead. They were paced by Magic Johnson, who had an all-star record 22 assists, and Continental League alumnus Ricky Green, who has earned his respect. But in the third quarter, led by Bernard King, the East stormed back and began to put a hex on the West. It was then that Isaiah Thomas took over. He hit Piston teammate Bill Laimbeer, and the East led by 9. But the West clawed back, and Magic tied the score with a running one-hander. The crowd loves a barn burner, and with 3 seconds left, Johnson put up a three-pointer. In overtime, Coach Layden developed strategy, but Isaiah Thomas went on a rampage. He and Andrew Toney combined for 14 points. The East won, and with 15 assists and 21 second-half points, Isaiah Thomas was chosen MVP.
This is the greatest, because on this day, it says that I was the best basketball player in the world, and that's a lot.
Isaiah Thomas was the man that day, but in 1984, the big name in the NBA was Johnson.
Same last name, 13 Johnsons play in the game. All of them Johnsons shoot in hoop. Too many Johnsons spoil the soup. You know and I know that pro b-ball is perhaps the roughest and the toughest game in them all. There's no two ways about it, it's a grueling sport. The hours are long, the career is short. It's difficult to make it in the NBA. Might a star today, the next day be far away. Possibly displaying for the folks in France the skills that he perfected for American fans. Or possibly demoted to the CBA because the dumb chump threw too many balls away. He might have split the scene with a ruptured spleen or quit pro ball to coach a college team. He might have parlayed his fame into calling the game before the crowd would call b-ball on the TV screen. Now doesn't all of this commotion raise considerable doubt as to who was in and who was out? It's impossible to keep track of the players who are hot, cause now they're here and next they're not. Just to show you what I mean, now please don't scream. There's 13 different Johnsons on as many different teams. 13 Johnsons playing ball. After the chorus, I'll name them all. 13 Johnsons playing the game. 13 men with the same last name. All of them fellows shooting hoop. Too many Johnsons spoil the soup. Irvin is the man, pops to the mind. If some magic is required when the Lakers are behind. He's only human but behaves bionic. Used to play with Clay, but Clay's gone supersonic. There's two Eddie Johnsons and they make me laugh. You can't tell one from the other when they sign their autograph. One plays for the Hawks, one plays for the Kings. The Georgia guy guards and the Kansas cat swings. One of them has got a bro, his family is hot. On the Bullets, Frank will beat you with a three-point shot. Two Georges as well. One highly rated, the other's been deactivated. There were two Johnson Sixers in 83. A fitty front court duality. Now Clement is big, he's huge, he's wide. Reggie got his high New Jersey fight. Vinny is the man up in the Motor City. He can play all day, but he ain't pretty. A beefy boy, first name was Steven. He was traded to Chicago in the middle of the season. That makes 10, but two more remain. There's a Mickey and a Marcus playing in this game. A defensive menace on the parquet floor. That's a Celtics Dennis getting down for the score. 13 men with the same last name. 13 Johnsons playing the game. 13 men with the same last name. 13 Johnsons playing the game. 13 men with the same last name. 13 Johnsons playing the game. 13 men with the same last name. 13 Johnsons playing the game. 13 men with the same last name. 13 Johnsons playing the game.
You play in the NBA to be the champion. The ambition and drive of the regular season is heightened as past victories are recalled and players eye the future. Each year, history is made and the NBA title becomes a quest. In 1983, Julius Erving and the Philadelphia 76ers finally got their rings. But as the 1984 playoffs began, it had been 15 years since a team had repeated as champion. The Sixers' opening round opponent were the up-and-coming New Jersey Nets, and the first game was immediately a shocker. Led by a revitalized Michael Ray Richardson, the Nets stunned the Sixers by winning by 15 points in Philadelphia. In the second game, the Sixers were sloppy, and the opportunistic Nets pulled off another double-digit victory. The young Nets, who had never won even a single playoff game in their NBA history, were psyched for the upset. Veteran 76ers were looking old. The Nets had captured the attention of the entire sports world with their ambition and drive. And returning to New Jersey, it was no joke to think of a sweep. Poor foul shooting kept the Nets within sight. And led by Mo Cheeks, the champion Sixers finally pounced on their young prey, taking game three and regaining their faltering confidence. Game four was more of the same, and coach Stan Albeck watched helplessly as his Nets were blown off the court by the rejuvenated Sixers. Moses Malone, who had been injured, came to life, and the Sixers were again supremely confident.
The pressure is on the Nets, and they've had success in Philadelphia. That should be a confidence factor for them, but they're not going to win in Philadelphia, so mail in the stats.
The series continued down the Jersey Turnpike to Philadelphia, where the Sixers felt they had the muscle to turn back the upstart Nets. But the Philly muscle was hurting and aging, and with Malone's knees aching, there was some question about them standing the test of time. Not to worry, these were champions. They knew how to win, and the Nets were just kids. With this basket, Mo Cheeks, who had a brilliant series, put the Sixers up by 7 with 7 minutes to play. It seemed all but over, and Albeck needed something, anything, to avert the inevitable. But led by the resurgent Michael Ray Richardson, the Nets climbed back. Michael Ray was the driving force, and it was the veteran Sixers who uncharacteristically turned the ball over. When Albert King tapped in this Otis Birdsong rebound, he sent the Sixers home for the summer. An amazing achievement, dethroning the defending NBA champions, beating them 3 times on their home court. In other Eastern action, the New York Knicks and Detroit Pistons split a pair. In Game 3, Bernard King scored 46 points, canning shots from all over the floor, playing with inspired intensity and pacing the Knicks to victory. New York needed one more win to advance, and coach Hubie Brown wanted it at home. But in Game 4, it was Isaiah Thomas, his 22 spectacular points and 16 assists along with 42 points from Kelly Trepiuka sent the series back to Detroit and pumped up the Pistons for the showdown in Motown. Joe Louis Arena was the site of this heavyweight battle, and Bernard King went for the knockout. He gave the Knicks a 3-point lead with only seconds remaining. But Isaiah Thomas would not let the Pistons lose. His 3-point jumper knotted the game. He scored an incredible 16 points in the final 94 seconds to send the game into overtime. OT was more of the same. Despite playing with the flu, Bernard King set a new 5-game playoff scoring record, and his points were decisive, averaging over 42 a game. Isaiah tried to keep pace, and for a while he did. But when he and Lane Beer fouled out, Bernard and the Knicks put the game away. Pistons coach Chuck Daly didn't want to throw in the towel, but the Knicks took this fight on points.
This is by far the most exciting game and the biggest game I've ever played in as a professional athlete. And it was fun because we won.
In round two, the Boston Celtics held a 3-2 lead when the Knicks returned to Madison Square Garden needing a win to stay in the hunt. The Knicks got off early, playing tenacious defense and being led by Bernard King, who was having one of those nights. Bernard hit for 18 points in the first quarter and at the half had 29. However, with 6 seconds left, the Knicks led by only 2. But when Larry Bird missed this shot and Cedric Maxwell the follow-up, the Knicks pushed the series to a deciding 7th game. Boston Garden was ready for the matchup. The Celtics had been devastating at home, and the fans expected the best. Boston ran off to a 10-point first quarter lead as the Knicks threw the ball away, and Larry Bird paced them with 28 points in the first half alone. The Celtics' defense finally stopped Bernard King, limiting him to 7 points before halftime and neutralizing him till the game was out of reach. But the game especially belonged to Larry Bird, who hit a personal career playoff high 39 points and led the Celtics into the next round. The Celtics watched most of the playoffs on TV last year because the Milwaukee Bucks beat them badly, but this year they were more relaxed. The Bucks waltzed through Atlanta, then took the Nets in six. But then came Boston. The Celtics had the league's best record and were set on revenge. They won two in Boston. And coach Don Nelson couldn't stop them from taking game three in Milwaukee. Paul McKeskey checked in for Buck center Bob Lanier. This might have been the great veteran's last hurrah. In fact, about the only Milwaukee bright spot was the play of the unlikely McKeskey, who scored 12 points in averting a Boston sweep. But the Celtics completed their turnaround in Boston and charged into the final. In the West, a spirited battle was being waged between youth and experience. The Dallas Mavericks, an expansion team making its first playoff appearance, won their first game at home, led by its young star, Mark Aguirre, the league's second leading scorer. But in the second game, score tied, Seattle went to veteran Gus Williams.
They get it to Gus. Oh, he got it. He got it in Seattle where? Gus Williams banks it off the glass at the buzzer.
The series was tied 2-2, and the deciding game was played at Southern Methodist University. Seattle led, but Dallas hung tough. And Rolando Blackman put up a clutch jumper that sent the game into overtime. With the series on the line, the young Mavericks just wanted it more. This was their first big-time battle, and they played hungrier. And with the Texas fans cheering them on, they won by a whisper, 105-104. Coach Frank Layden had the Utah Jazz at their peak.
I think that ours was the most amazing athletic feat of the year. I think that there wasn't another baseball team, basketball team, football team, hockey, who was picked to come in so low and to do so poorly and yet achieve so much.
The Jazz won the Midwest Division title, beat the Denver Nuggets in round one, and beat the Phoenix Suns in game one, round two. Coach John McLeod's Suns had struggled all season, but won their last eight regular season games and then upset the strong Portland Trail Blazers in the first round. Larry Nance was developing into a dominant force in the league as the Suns won games 2, 3, and 4. Walter Davis, nicknamed the Greyhound, led the Suns as they won in six and ran into the conference final. The Greyhound was going to need a fast start and a lot of drive, however, to keep up with the Los Angeles Lakers. The Lakers had swept the Kansas City Kings and lost only one game in beating Dallas. The squad was deep and strong and overwhelmingly talented. The Lakers took the first game easily and the second as Magic Johnson dished out a playoff record 24 assists. Things were looking dark for Phoenix. But at this late hour, the Suns came out at night. Led by the streaking Greyhound, Phoenix rose from their ashes and won game three. LA took game four, however, and returned home needing only a victory to reach the finals. But the Suns refused to go down. Davis was brilliant, and Larry Nance skied as the Suns won going away, and the series surprisingly returned to Phoenix. The Lakers were concerned, but intense, young veterans in another pressure situation. With time winding down, the Lakers were up by two. The Suns needed a basket to tie. The Lakers squeezed through and entered their third consecutive championship series, their fourth in the last 5 years. Historic struggles between the Celtics and Lakers have defined the NBA Finals. Boston had beaten the Lakers seven times without a loss, but that was long ago. A tradition felt more by today's fans than today's players. Now there is a new dynamic, Larry Bird and Irvin Magic Johnson. Irvin became Magic at Michigan State University, and in the 1979 NCAA Finals, he led his team to the national title over Larry Bird and Indiana State. They entered the NBA the same year and quickly developed into superstars, and the two have always been compared and contrasted. The 1984 NBA World Championship Series was a media circus.
I don't know, what can you guys really work on in practice after the performance on Sunday? I mean,
each team was strong, and the game was filled with fine players and engaging personalities. The court coverage was intense, in the press, and on the tube. This was prime time. The Lakers arrived in Boston tired the day after beating Phoenix. They would have only one day's rest before beginning the finals. They held practice in their hotel ballroom to keep the travel to a minimum. The Celtics, on the other hand, were rested, loose, and very much at home. Casey Jones was the major link to the traditional Celtic greatness, having played on 8 championship Celtic teams. He knew the psychological value of those flags flying in Boston Garden. The Celtics had compiled the league's best record, but by game time, somehow they had become underdogs to the favored Lakers. And the loud and rabid Boston fans cheered them as if on a crusade. Abdul-Jabbar had come down with a serious migraine, missed practice, and was not expected to be at his best. But it was the Lakers who got off quickly. Coach Pat Riley ran his team with precision, and the Lakers ran off to a 20-6 lead and never looked back. Casey Jones tried to slow down the Laker drive, but it was Abdul-Jabbar who set the tone of the game. Though consistently double-teamed, he hit the open man, rebounded, and led the Lakers in scoring despite the effects of the migraine. It was an overpowering performance, and Celtics center Robert Parrott, who had not faced a dominating big man so far in the playoffs, simply could not handle it.
Well, he was on fire. You know, everything he threw up went in just about. You know, he shot the ball very well. You know, it's going to be one of those days.
What can I say about it?
They came off one day's plane ride and then just started right off going at us. And they just went out and just took the game away from us in that first quarter.
Kareem finished with 32 points and more praise from his coach.
He's a very gallant, proud man who has accomplished everything that any man can accomplish in sport. He impresses me because he's a man. And this game was for men only today. If that thing would have been pulsating and pounding, I think he would have showed up.
Kareem had a more concrete description of his frequent migraine attack.
It's like a physical, it's like a mechanical thing, like your tires being out of line.
The Celtics had been stunned by game one and held practice behind closed doors in an attempt to regroup. Something had to be done. Inside, the Celtics had to have been confused. They had been run ragged by the Laker break and their game plan had come up empty. Robert Parrish had been overmatched in the pivot, stifling their defense. And although Kevin McHale had played well, the Celtic fortunes rested even more heavily in the hands of Larry Bird. Larry Bird was the league's premier all-round player and Boston's favorite. And Michael Cooper, perhaps the league's best on defense, was assigned to guard him.
Well, you don't stop a Larry Bird. What you try to do is contain them, make them take something that they don't want to take. Instead of giving Larry a 15-footer, we'd like to have him to take an 18-footer with a hand or two hands in his face.
Cooper stayed with him. He had always been aggressive and played Bird tough. On defense, Casey Jones had developed a strategy to deal with Kareem. The Celtics helped Parrish by putting two and sometimes three men on the Lakers' center, dropping off a guard and sometimes a forward to stop the big man. In the first half, the strategy worked as the Celtics pried the ball loose and led by as many as 15 points. But the Lakers came back and, with time running down, forced a turnover and raced for the basket to cut the lead to two at the half. Celtic fans were anxious as the game seesawed. Boston led by one late in the fourth quarter when James Worthy went over his defenders for the score. He was fouled and made the free throw for a two-point Laker lead. With 20 seconds left, Kevin McHale was fouled and had a chance to tie the game. But he missed both free throws and the Lakers got the rebound and called time. Things looked dark for the Celtics. The game had gotten out of their hand. Jack Nicholson figured that was Boston's last gasp. While Riley diagrammed the inbounds play, Casey Jones tried to conjure a response. Only diehard Celtic fans could hope for a miracle, like the one Boston announcer Johnny Mose called in the Celtics 76er Conference Finals in 1965.
Greer is going to throw the ball in. Johnny?
Greer is putting the ball on a play. He gets it out deep, and Havlicek steals it.
But miracles do happen.
And now to Magic. Back over to Worthy, and it's picked off. Toss to Henderson, he lays it off and in. It's all tied up. A great play by Henderson.
But the Lakers could still win it. Worthy inbounded to Byron Scott, who got the ball to Magic Johnson.
Down to 9 seconds. Magic holding the ball. Magic trying to work on Maxwell. Magic has still got it down to 2 seconds. 1 second. He's going to have to shoot it. He doesn't get it off. They get no shot at all.
The game went into overtime. The Celtics given new life and spirit. The fans thought Magic's game was coming apart. And Magic himself seemed uncharacteristically anxious. The overtime period was a struggle, and with the score tied, Scott Wedman put one up from the corner. Down by two, the Lakers could still tie, but Robert Parrish stripped Bob McAdoo, and suddenly it was over. The Lakers knew they had given this game away. But it went into the Celtics scorebook as a victory, and the man of the hour was Gerald Henderson.
Well, for a minute there, I could hear Johnny Mose going, "Henderson steals the ball!"
The Celtics had gained a split with more than a touch of the leprechaun. But when the series came to the Forum, Laker fans had their own set of unexpected heroes. Kurt Rambis is the working class of the NBA. And in the third game, his coach, Pat Riley, said he was decisive.
He established an aggressive posture for us at the beginning of the game with the way he played. And it was contagious for our players. That's his job. That's his role. And that in itself is a talent. Hustle is a talent.
Rambis' rebounding and scoring sparked the Laker fast break. And in front of the hometown fans, L.A. went on a roll and ran the Celtics ragged.
The first three teams we played, they were non-running teams. It was slow it down. And L.A. is hit your wagons up and let's go, boys.
They have guys running all the time. They have a non-stop offense. And, you know, it's like waves. They just whoosh, whoosh, whoosh. And Kareem could run it, and I'd quit.
It's like out at the Santa Monica Beach when the waves are coming in and one wave comes after another and after another.
It's like a snowball rolling down a hill. Once we get it started, we just caught up in it. It's just like entertainment for the fans.
Grooving, you in sync and in an unbelievable high because it's rolling. And when it's rolling, it's hard to stop. Everyone you meet, they're jamming in the street all night long. Yeah, I said, everyone you meet, they're jamming in the street all night long. Feel good, feel good.
In game three, James Worthy got the spotlight and he may never give it up. Starting in place of the ailing Jamal Wilkes, the second-year man strutted his stuff.
James is a revelation. He really is. I mean, he's something special that has come into this league, and he has a fearless attitude as far as finishing anything that goes to the basket.
In L.A., they had a new star, and with a record 47 third-quarter points, the Lakers were looking like champions. People were already talking about Worthy walking off with the award for playoff MVP. The game was a rout, the most lopsided defeat in Boston playoff history, and the Celtics looked like beaten men.
I've been in a lot of embarrassing situations before, but this is definitely one of them, you know. I just feel that, you know, we got some great players on this team, but we don't have the players with the heart sometimes that we need. And until we get our hearts where they belong, we're in trouble.
Bird called his teammates sissies, challenged the entire squad. And the Lakers were loose, confident, and happy. As far as they were concerned, they'd won all three games. The second game loss, a minor slip-up. And their fans basked in the victory.
Well, it's very evident that the Lakers have things well in hand. And we'll take command of the next game and the end of the series.
I'm a Celtic fan, but I'm pretty dismal for the Celtics' hopes this year.
The Lakers were feeling fabulous in the Forum. But Cedric Maxwell maintained his sense of humor.
Rambus boys. Yeah, hey, come on, let's sit right here with the sign. Let's stand together.
The 1981 playoff MVP had not looked good against his Laker rival.
Max, throw some glasses now.
Hey, no. I can't put on the Kurt Rambis glasses. No. I think Kurt Rambis fake nose, too. Let me see. How does the Rambis glasses go?
The Lakers' championship chances were looking excellent. While Red Auerbach huddled with L.A. Raiders owner Al Davis, the Celtics were talking tough.
This is not the marching down, boys. This is marching on to victory. That's what it is. March of Dam is already out on the floor.
For Game 4, the Forum fans were unusually vocal, and the Celtics' bravado was matched by the Lakers' easy confidence. The Lakers continued right where they left off, running to a 10-point halftime lead. They were looking spectacular. Casey Jones knew that unless he changed strategy, Boston would lose to the Los Angeles high style of Showtime finesse. In the heat of the moment, Boston developed a battle plan. The Eastern Conference was known for its physical play, and with few fouls called, the Celtics went on the attack. Riley was furious as the combat grew intense. And the game turned on a crucial play. LA rebounded and broke for the basket.
Cooper to Kareem, to Worthy, to Rambis. He should go the distance. Oh, look out!
Kurt Rambis was clotheslined by Kevin McHale, and a hard-fought game developed hard feelings. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar, noted more for his finesse play than his elbows, crashed the boards with a vengeance. He and Larry Bird faced off, and tempers flared. The Lakers' cool was blown. Instead of setting the tone, they found themselves retaliating, and their well-honed concentration was disrupted. The Lakers ran, but the Celtics clawed back, using anger as motivation. And by the end of the third quarter, they had sliced the Laker lead to 2. Dennis Johnson was key in the resurgence, and the Celtics crashed the board. Robert Parrish, who had been outplayed all series, emerged from his shell and began to make his presence felt. The game was tight the whole fourth quarter, but the physical pounding paid off for Boston. When, after scoring 32 points, Kareem Abdul-Jabbar fouled out. The Lakers led by 2, and Larry Bird's 2 free throws tied the game with 16 seconds left to play. The Lakers had several options and enough time to operate, but just barely. With Kareem gone, Magic dribbled down and looked for Worthy.
Magic with 7, with 6. Magic takes the ball and they throw. Magic throws
it
away.
Look at this.
3 seconds, intercepted by Parrish. Magic threw it right to Parrish.
Again, Magic seemed unnerved. There was time enough to win, and after trailing most of the game, the Celtics could tie the series on 1 shot. Johnson inbounded to Bird. McHale's shot would have counted, but the game was tied. The Celtics had picked themselves up, and once again, it was into overtime. The Lakers took a small lead, then lost it, and with under a minute left, the Lakers broke for the basket. But it was called back, and instead of a 3-on-1 fast break, an almost certain score, Magic Johnson had to go to the line for 2. He missed them both. In the Boston huddle, the word was for Bird.
Maxwell looking. Bird rotates in. Bird pops out, avoids the steal. Gets it over to DJ. Bird goes right into the pivot. Now DJ holds the ball. Back into Bird. The fall away is gone. Boston leads 125 to 123 as the Lakers call timeout.
But with 10 seconds left, James Worthy was fouled. His 2 free throws could tie the game again. He missed the first, and the LA fans could feel the game slipping away. Maxwell fueled the fire, and Kareem couldn't bear to watch, and Worthy hit the next one. The Lakers quickly fouled Dennis Johnson, who made his 2, and LA set up for a 3-point attempt to tie the game again.
10 seconds in overtime. Worthy stolen by Emil Carr. And the Boston Celtics have evened this NBA World Championship Series at 2 games apiece.
Carr did a lot of cheerleading, but Larry Bird was still not impressed with his team's fortunate victory.
Larry, last time you quoted just saying you guys played like sissies. What's the word you use for the team now from this game?
Well, we just played like a bunch of women tonight. We can still play a lot harder.
The series returned east. The Lakers had lost the home court advantage, which rested now with Boston. The historic city was sweltering with a press of humidity. Temperatures in the 90s and no relief in sight. With the series tied, to win game 5, someone had to beat the Heat.
It's going to be hot there, and I think the Celtics are more used to the heat than LA is.
All around Boston, Celtic fans saw the complexion of the series change. Boston Garden was a sauna. The place had no air conditioning. And inside, as the temperatures reached into the hundreds, the Lakers tried to relax and stay fresh. The Celtics had turned the series around. The question was, could they keep the heat on?
This is going to keep me cool tonight. If I didn't have this, I wouldn't be able to stay in here tonight.
Dennis Johnson maintained his cool. Game four had shown the Celtics that they could, in fact, win this thing. And the key was the decision to put Dennis Johnson on Magic Johnson. DJ stuck to him like sweat, always there. He pushed Magic outside, didn't let him set up the Laker offense. Frustrated him openly. DJ's offense, which had been dormant, came to life as he hit from the outside and penetrated the sticky Laker defense. The veteran warmed to the task, and after leading by only two at halftime, the Celtics began to pull away. But the guy who really buried the Lakers was Larry Bird. Having criticized his teammates, the Celtic captain took it upon himself to lead them. Moving without the ball, hitting from all over the court, bustling for position underneath, he played a brilliant all-round game. Casey Jones loved his competitive fight.
Larry Bird, he's a coal miner. He gets up every morning and goes down in the coal mines and gets down in the dirt and works. And he just went to the boards and went in low, got the offensive boards, and put the ball in the hoop.
4 seconds! Shoot it! Shoot it! Shoot it!
All his shots began to fall, and as the Lakers seemed to wilt in the heat, the Celtics grew stronger. Bird had an extraordinary game, scoring 34 points on 15 of 20 from the field and grabbing 17 rebounds. The Lakers were beaten soundly. They seemed unnerved, unable to respond. The Celtics smoked L.A. 121-103.
We have to give both teams tremendous credit for playing a 48-minute steam bath. It seems as though they held up a little better than we did. The man who made the difference tonight was Mr. Bird.
Dennis Johnson was modest and sly about what he'd done on defense.
I did nothing. Was I on Magic?
Larry Bird led his team west with a chance to win it all in L.A. Time was running out for the Lakers. Their overwhelming confidence was gone. And although they felt they had the better team on paper and in concept, they had to prepare themselves for serious combat. Lose this, and it was over. The usually restrained Forum crowd was in a frenzy. They had seen Boston Garden erupt and went all out for the Lakers. Ex-Laker guard Norm Nixon, who had been traded before the season, was greeted warmly and wistfully. His absence in the backcourt had put a lot of pressure on Magic. And in the playoff finals, Magic had been having his problems. Hounded by Dennis Johnson, Magic found it hard to get the LA offense in gear. And the Celtics had turned Laker mistakes into easy baskets. The Lakers couldn't solve the Celtic defense, and the Celtics were running away with the championship. The Lakers were frustrated and looking for revenge. James Worthy decked Cedric Maxwell, perhaps in retaliation, perhaps to psych his teammates. But late in the third period, the Celtics were in command, and Laker coach Pat Riley was struggling to come up with a solution.
I groped right for the right player. I groped for Byron Scott. And old Scotty came in, and
he's the one that really was the catalyst at turning the whole thing around for us.
The rookie guard who had arrived in the Norm Nixon trade hit from the outside when Kareem was double-teamed. With With the crowd in an uproar, he snaked a key steal and put in a sweet dipsy doodle of his own. Byron Scott rose to the occasion and almost by himself drove the Lakers to tie the game. Then Abdul-Jabbar took over. Although plagued that morning by another crushing migraine, Kareem played at his height. In a rare pregame locker room speech, he had reminded his teammates about will and desire and victory coming from within, and he demonstrated all of that and more. He was playing with passion and pride.
You hear a lot about Celtic tradition and Celtic pride. We have some proud athletes here too, and they're not the only team with pride.
Kareem finished with 30 points and 10 rebounds, and the Lakers won going away. The Celtics headed home, where the Lakers would try to do it again.
Oh boy, well, I think we're gonna try to order another migraine for Tuesday.
Byron Scott deserved the spotlight, and there would once again be a Boston Garden showdown.
Everything is back there to be had. History, the Boston Garden, retired numbers, world championship banners. We have a chance to do something that no other team has ever done. Go back to Boston Garden and win a world championship on that parquet floor.
The Celtics had never lost a World Championship Series seventh game, and that winning tradition had become a Boston birthright. The mood was concentrated and intense, and the Celtics stood ready to answer all questions about the team's character and heart.
By far the fastest heart I've heard.
Am I ready or what?
The media attention reflected great national interest, and glorious Celtics past revisited the site of past Celtic glory. The celebrated Laker faithful were on hand. And who was that with former Commissioner Larry O'Brien? But mostly, this was a classic occasion for your basic basketball fan.
Hi there once again, everybody. This is Johnny Bowe. I'm up courtside here at the Boston Garden.
I'm Chick Hearn. And tonight, the seventh game of the World Championship,
where the Boston Celtics and the Los Angeles Lakers get ready for
the World Championship of Basketball 1983-84
in game number seven
from historic Boston Garden.
The World Series of Basketball, the NBA Championship Series.
What Celtic fans lack in subtlety, they make up for in volume. Boston had lost only once at home all playoffs, and the riotous Garden atmosphere inspired them again. But the Lakers were not bowing to tradition. They were making their run at the crown, and the score was tied at the end of the first quarter. Great games bring out great performances, and Cedric Maxwell responded to the call. A former playoff MVP, Maxwell had become a role player in Boston's offense, but in game seven, he heard his number called a lot. He worked outside and down low, forcing his way to the basket, and he spent a lot of time at the free throw line. The Celtics fought out to a 6-point halftime lead and what they hoped would be their 15th NBA title. In the third quarter, the Celtics opened it up with quick hands, bruising defense, and some accurate outside shooting from reserve Celtic role players like Danny Ainge. The Lakers had lost their composure, and when Boston scored the last 9 points and stretched their lead to 13, the Celtics seemed only moments away from their goal. But the Lakers had their own pride, and in the fourth quarter, they stormed back, hitting the boards, playing with championship intensity, and cutting into the lead. Down to 5.5 minutes to go, and the Lakers look poised for one of their classic runs. But DJ stripped Magic and raced for the hoop. Cooper pinned him clean, saving a game breaker, and the Lakers raced back. Worthy hit, and the lead was down to 3. The championship that had seemed so secure was in peril, but Boston still had Bird and they went to him. A big miss. The Lakers moved down court. They could close within one. But Magic Johnson forced it up. The ball turned over, and Dennis Johnson again went to the hole. This time he was fouled. Pat Riley could see the championship fading. Johnson's free throws brought the lead to 5, and Riley could stop the clock, but not the Celtics celebration. Boston fans saw their tradition continue. A new set of faces in the championship picture. The Lakers would remember for a long time the one they let get away. Larry Bird's 2 free throws capped the scoring, and in moments, the Celtics would be champion. Time finally ran out on the talented Lakers. It was Boston's year. Boston celebrated a new generation of Celtic champions, ball players who carried and were carried by Boston's winning tradition. Larry Bird was chosen the playoff MVP, and Red Auerbach grasped his 15th NBA title. In the Laker locker room, there was great frustration, and the thoughts were on how they lost and what might have been.
They outrebounded. They did a great job, and that's why they were champs. You know, we helped them, we gave it to them, and they won it at the same time.
In this series, Commissioner,
what a spectacular
NBA
finale!
NBA Commissioner David Stern did the honor.
It's my pleasure to present the Larry O'Brien Trophy to the NBA World Champion 1984 Boston Celtics.
Right.
Congratulations to Red Auerbach. Number 15, what a way to go.
The Celtics had moved their tradition forward. The entire city was overwhelmed by the players' passion and the Celtics' pride. Yes, we got seven.